Welcome to Peninsula Seniors Out and About. Today we're at the Western Museum of Flight in Torrance for one of their celebrity lectures. Let's go see what Cindy has for us today.
Welcome everyone to the Western Museum of Flight. I'm Cindy Maka and I'm the director of the museum. None of us have lived through the ordeal of being a prisoner of war, and we can't really comprehend what it was like. But as citizens, we should never forget that some people have had to pay that price, and sadly, and most certainly, will have to continue to do so in the future. So to give us a small glimpse of that grim reality, we are fortunate today to have a gentleman who has survived that ordeal, and it is my privilege to introduce to you Tony Marshall.
Thank you, Cindy. Good morning, and thanks to everyone for coming out this morning to hear me tell a few lies. I am going to give you a couple of disclaimers to start with. The first one is, I'm sure all of you know, everybody that wears a uniform and raises the hand takes the same chances. Some of us get to do a little extra duty, but I don't claim to have done anything special. It's just luck of the draw. You'll have to forgive me if I tend to be irreverent at times. I call them as I see them. And again, I don't apologize for it. I'm old-fashioned. That's just the way I was raised. My heroes come from the old school, and that's the way I like things. So with that, we'll just press on into this. I have some basic rules that I live by. They're up there summarized real quick. And number three in particular, you'll see woven through this story where the Vietnamese violated rule number three, which worked to my favor. But that's kind of the way I look at life. And those who have volunteered have no right to complain. So I don't hate rice. I don't dislike Vietnamese. I have no bitterness against anything. I played the game, took my chances, and I got off a lot easier than the folks who were there for a long time. That's my outfit. The 13th, and as anybody who's been in an outfit will tell you, it's the greatest outfit in the world. I absolutely believe that. We had a great time. We had a fantastic mascot, Eldridge. I spent a year there, had my normal tour. It was fun. Yeah, you're being shot at, who cares? You know, they missed. So again, I'm a little odd in the brain. But I finished my tour, and everybody who had good sense said, boy, go home. And I thought, nah, I'm having too much fun. I'm going to stick around. That was my downfall. It actually was a great time. That was my first mission. And the rules were if you got through 10 missions, you were combat ready. So I made it through my 10 real easy. There's our mascot, Eldridge. We also had a python, a honey bear. We had all kinds of critters. Most of you who have flown can realize how dumb that is. And we've actually done that with a full load of bombs doing close trail playing around because we're bored after a mission. But I put that in there because that centerline tank comes into play later on. Now, I have to tell you that I love taking pictures. My hobby was taking pictures. So I took my camera on almost every mission. They don't let you do that anymore. They've lost their sense of humor because a lot of people did dumb things. But I really enjoyed flying. This is one of our missions just on the tanker heading out. I love airplanes, so you're going to have to sit through the dialogue and look at all the pictures of airplanes. Then we'll get to talking about things. That's an F-105, and again, the big missile hanging under the wing comes into play later. It's a standard arm with the weasels. This is the first mission going downtown. It's kind of hard to see, but we're in number two airplane. That's three and four there, and if you look real close, that's that 105 with the standard arm lurking behind us. Didn't surprise me when this standard arm came roaring through our flight because I already knew that the good guys were back behind us. But this is on the way to Hanoi, and that's Thud Ridge in the background. And the standard arm's headed off to some poor guy that's sitting at a radar site who doesn't know what's about to happen. World War II type flak. That's probably the only mission I saw flak on. Now, I saw lots of tracers, lots of time, but this is the only time we really got in the heart of the flak going on. There's lead and number two rolling in. And again, I'm taking pictures right in the middle of combat. There's nothing else to do right now, you know. Look around, see who's shooting at you. But the MiGs were not up, so I got time to take pictures. Guillaume Airport, right in downtown Hanoi. And I'm sure a lot of you read the story about the Navy crew that strafed the Soviet ship in the harbor and how they stopped the entire war to go after those guys. And as we're rolling in, we notice three or four Soviet transports down there, and we were tempted to change our target and take those airplanes out. But discretion being the better part of valor, we realized that would probably be the end of our careers also. So we went ahead and dumped our bombs right at the base of the smoke of all the POW storage that had been bombed on that mission. That's what happens if you encounter a 37-millimeter. These poor guys were number three in our flight doing a strike over the DMZ, and as they came off target, we got the call, I'm hit. The right engine quit right then. The left engine quit when they landed at NKP on rollout, so they were extremely lucky. But that was one of the few times I'd actually seen an airplane take a hit in one of my flights. Now this gets into some interesting things. This is a page from Robin Ohl's book, Fighter Pilot, and I didn't realize this until I read his book. But during the time he was over there, there was a sort of a rule that the Vietnamese had weapons tight zone below 3,500 feet. They didn't shoot at their own airplanes, so they knew to disappear down low. Nobody told us that. And this is one of the problems we had in this war, of people sitting on secrets and not telling the people that needed to know the information. I had an incident, and it was January. We did a scramble off the alert pad to go intercept some MiGs. And we went racing up there, which is probably, when you're sitting on alert, that's the greatest thing you can do. Send me in, coach. So we take off, you finish strapping in as you climb out, go racing up toward the border. And there's a map right here that gives you an outline of where Southeast Asia is, for those that aren't familiar with it. But Udorn is right here, Hanoi is there, and this is where we headed. And right there is an area called the Fish's Mouth, which is where we'd normally cross the border. As we got just to the border, we got a call that the threat had disappeared. And our instructions were to go take up an orbit out in the PDJ, the Plain of Jars, which normally would have been a left turn. Lucky for us, we had the early version of the combat tree gear, which picks up the Soviet IFF. And I was in the lead airplane in the back seat, and I have to explain that. I'm a backseater at this time. But I got an indication on the radar on the right side that there was MiG activity fairly close. So I asked my pilot to turn right instead of the normal left turn. But I could not pick out a radar contact, so we continued the right turn around, did not cross the border, and then proceeded out west. And as we rolled out of the turn, we got a call identifying us by a call sign. And the call was, "Break hard, they're on your ass shooting." Okay, so we continued our right turn back around. I'm back in the radar scope, and I'm looking. I pick up the indications again, but I still cannot break out the skin paint. So there was one mistake in the D model, the radar on 25 and 50 mile scope. You had no indication which one you were on. It was just a button to go from one to the other. I thought I was on 50, but I was on 25. At any point, when the MiG got down to 5 miles and I couldn't break it out and we're doing a head-on pass, it's time to look outside. So I asked my front seater to look at 2 o'clock level and there should be a MiG there. And sure enough, when I looked out the window, there was a beautiful silver MiG-21 there. I was just mesmerized. Picked up the camera real quick, took a shot. I told you I was crazy. But the only problem was I didn't have my camera. I had the shop camera, and they had the long lens on it, so obviously I didn't get the picture, but I wanted to. At the same time, I'm watching this MiG come at us, and we had gone down. We're starting back up. MiG is headed down, opposite direction, and he fires an ATOL. And again, I'm mesmerized. Beautiful red flame. There's a big red star on the tail. And it's the first MiG I've seen. And I think, okay, head on, he's pointed down with an ATOL. It's not going to hurt us. And then I thought, oh boy, we had a wingman. Maybe he's shooting at our wingman, who should have been on the other side. So I looked out to my left. The wingman is still there. Now, those of you who have flown in Southeast Asia, remember at that time, we were flying fighting wing, which is a stupid formation to go into combat with. The wingman is tucked right here. He's just hanging on for dear life. I look over, the wingman's still there, so this missile is no threat. While I'm looking backward, two more ATOLs go over our head, follow the smoke trail back, and there's a MiG-21 that has turned in front of us after he fired. And I'm looking around the side. I can see this MiG sitting on top of the gun sight. And I'm telling my front seater, all you've got to do is pull the nose up about 5 degrees, go heat, hit the rudder pedals, you got him. Well, at that point, our wingman calls bingo, which means I have to go home for gas. And the rules in my squadron were, at that point, the fight was over. If you haven't already pulled the trigger, you honor that call. So we turned in the direction of the last known threat, which was the guy that fired at us first, and headed home. And we did not go straight home. We headed out west instead of going southwest. And as we're headed west, we get a call that the two MiGs that originally were going to shoot at us were waiting for us on the way home. Well, we went around them, did an end run, headed home. Now, we get out of the airplane, and I talked to the wingman and said, well, what did you see? They didn't see anything until we were headed west. And the backseater looked back and could see a MiG-21 behind us looking for us. But because the airplane was camouflaged, they couldn't see us against the jungle. So we're doing the back slapping, yucking it up, talking about what a great fight it was, talking with our hands and shooting our watches. And we had a Navy exchange guy who came in and said, you know, you guys really don't know how close you came to dying today. So, of course, we tell him, yeah, great. We know. Wasn't any big deal. We were there. They shot. No big deal. Well, when they looked at the radar film from my camera, when you look at it at normal speed, it was just like I described it. But when you ran it at half speed, as we rolled out of that brake turn, a MiG-19 went down each side of the scope. And what the Soviets knew, I keep calling them the Soviets, Vietnamese, same difference. They knew that if the threat disappeared, we would be turned at the border. So they would send a high plane that the radar would track, it would disappear, and then we would be left high and dry, but there was somebody down low that was waiting for us to turn in front of them. And that's exactly what that call was. Now, said all that to say this. I was intrigued after that about who gave us that warning call, did some calls, and actually located the controller who was on the airplane that gave us the warning. My first question was, when did you know there was a threat there? And he chuckled, as Robin says, and he said, we listened to the guys from the time they got up and had their briefing. We heard them taxi out, the whole intercept, and then we heard them clear to fire. And I think everybody can anticipate my next question, why didn't you give us some warning when we could have been offensive? And his response was exactly the same thing. We didn't want to let them know what our capability was. And this is the kind of war we fought. So, long story behind that. 289, that's the actual airplane that we dropped in the bushes when we jumped out. That's a Seymour Johnson bird. The guy on the left there, the two guys in the foreground, Dan Cherry and Fred Olmsted, were MiG killers, so they're just back talking about their mission. The guy on the left is actually the guy that was my pilot on this flight. And he had a reputation of doing maverick things. He also carried the extra gun, the knife, and was going to fight his way out. But what we had against him in particular was he liked to go after a particular target every morning. And this was forward air control. We were doing fast FAC mission. And our job was to go mark targets. But there was a ferry boat on the Quang Ki River that was under a piece of karst, and he wanted to get this boat. So he went after it every day. So violating all the rules about being predictable, going below altitude. And this was my first time I was flying with him, and we had a little chat before the mission, and I told him, like I briefed everybody else, look, don't even think about doing that. It's dumb, and I won't put up with it. And you got to understand, as a backseater, you have to have a certain amount of trust in your front seater. And everyone else that I had flown with, we'd have a discussion, we'd agree on it, and we'd execute it that way. So I thought, fine. So we took off and headed over, and I'm not paying attention, but when we get to the river, next thing I know, I'm in. And he actually gets the boat. Okay, and I'm thinking, whew, and I'm puckered all the way down and out because I'm thinking we're going to get hit. Because in all of his gun camera film, you'd notice he had to pull off just before he hit the karst, and the bullets would stop about 20 feet in front of the boat. Well, he figured out how to get it, and I thought, okay, good. That's out of his system, but I will never fly with this guy again. We went out and refueled. Next time, the tanker wasn't on station, so we headed down to Da Nang to refuel. Briefed with some guys from Uban that were dropping smart bombs. They were going to follow us up. So we took off, waited for them, and they came up. And that's when it hit the fan. As near as we can tell, and this is something I learned after I got home, what they assume happened is that centerline tank on our airplane collapsed. And history behind the centerline tank, it's 600 gallons. There are no baffles in it. It's just a big empty shell. It was not designed for combat flying. It was designed for one-time throwaway use. But we flew them. And they also had a bad habit of skipping along the bottom of the airplane and hitting the stabilator when you jettison them. So we had to do a 0.3G maneuver to get rid of them. So a lot of problems with that tank. But as near as we can tell, and this is from the guys who had the laser scope, the one who was watching the TV, saw us go down, saw something white come off the airplane, a puff of vapor, and saw the airplane hit the ground. It was that quick. I got one swing in the chute. He pulled the handles. Now, I had no idea I was going out of the airplane. First thing you learn as a backseater is some front seaters like to play games with you, get your head in the scope and then pull 6 Gs. So you always stay in ejection posture. I have my camera with me. So I'm going to take pictures of the ejection and sell them to Life and retire, if that works. But as I said, we did the rocket on the ground. And when we went back and analyzed the tape, the rocket's on the ground. He's calling corrections off the rocket, and we're still proceeding down. And the only conclusion is he was going down to strafe the target, which, again, is silly if somebody's going to drop a 2,000-pound bomb on it. But then again, my part as silly is I'm thinking there's going to be a great fireworks show, so I'm putting a fresh roll of film in the camera. And the next thing I know is boom. And the old brain says, you heard an explosion, but you didn't feel anything. And that's as far as I got in that analysis. Next thing I know, the whole world went white. That was because as the seat went up the rails, the boom I heard was my canopy leaving. He didn't have time to tell me anything. Airplane's out of control. And we're close to the ground. Estimated 550 knots, 3,500 feet going down, which is technically out of the envelope. But canopy's gone, and as I peep over that rail at 600 miles an hour with the wind in my face and no visor down, everything went white. The next thing I remember is standing on the ground, and the airplanes are racing by, and they don't sound like they do in the pattern. There's something different in the sound of the engines. And then there's this classic out-of-body experience. I'm standing there, and I'm watching this fool standing there with this radio in his hand, and the parachute's over the left shoulder, draped over a little scrub brush, banana tree over this shoulder. And they told me later that I was just babbling like crazy. They finally told me, just shut up, and we'll ask you some questions. Give us one click for yes, two clicks for no. Are you injured? No. Okay. And then the next thing I know, there's a semicircle of 6, 7 people in green uniforms, pith helmets, and AK-47s. I think, oops. So we had to carry a 38, which I never carried loaded because, one, I'm not a real gun enthusiast. If I have a gun, I'm going to shoot somebody. But if you got to come down in the parachute blazing away, you're in trouble. But again, the way I look at it, if you're going to send me to war, give me a real gun. 38 is like a cap pistol. So if you've got an AK-47 and you hear somebody shoot a 38, that's who I'm going to shoot. So I never carried it loaded. Somehow I convinced them that the 38 was unloaded, dropped it. They still didn't relax because I had the survival vest on, and they realized that I've got gyro jets and signal devices and all kinds of stuff. So took the survival vest off. They still weren't relaxed. They wanted the flight suit off, so took the flight suit off. Then they relaxed. A couple of them went over and started playing with the zippers and the Velcro tape. And they were just having a good time playing with this stuff. And then next thing I remember is, now this was 6 p.m., which is 3 hours before sunset. Next thing I remember, it's after dark. I'm squatting in a hole in the ground with my elbows tied behind me with nothing on but my skivvies. And at that point, finally reality sets in and I say, oh fudge. And I say it out loud so somebody hears me, shines a flashlight down and says, come up. And as I go to push to get up, all I feel is brass. And I'm thinking at this point, they're going to shoot me, and they've been waiting until I know what's going on. And my life didn't flash before my eyes or anything. I was just extremely upset. And I was upset because I had survived a fireworks show. Nobody would know what happened to me. The worst part, though, was there wasn't a damn thing I could do about it or anybody else could do about it. I'm almost on the opposite side of the globe from where I should be, which is home. This is an undeclared war. I got no business being here, and they just burst my little bubble. Well, they didn't shoot me. They didn't even do the mock execution, which a lot of prisoners went through. Some guy came down out of the hill with a checkerboard turban on, one of the local tribes, and I'm not sure what went on. They talked and gestured, and the next thing I know, they marched me off to jail. They had to restage the capture for propaganda, so they found a little girl in black pajamas to take a gun and capture me. They did that for the film. And then it's time for the first interrogation. So this is where we get into the fun part. Now, I went through survival school at the Air Force Academy. I went through survival school at Fairchild, and then I had a top-off course at Clark. And several different versions of how to do it, but you got the basic code of conduct. Name, rank, serial number, date of birth is the base, okay? Clark said, if you see a camera, run and get in front of it because we want to know you're alive. We can use that as leverage. And if you can say something that you would say while you're at home, you're okay. So, and I had rehearsed a tale that I was a combat photographer, just got there, didn't know squat about Jack. That was my tale. Now, they told me in survival school it wouldn't work, but I'm going to do it anyway. So sure enough, we get to the interrogation, and they want to know, what base did you come from? I think, let me see. They've been talking to us by call sign, so they know that. So I'm not going to get beat over that. They wanted to know the pilot's name. And I said, well, I just got here. They threw me in the back, said, take some pictures. The guy's name is Steve something. And if you see his name in red, everything in red, there's a message. Okay, the 601st Photo Squadron was at UDORM. So when this news release went out, the guys at UDORM were rolling on the floor laughing because they knew I had rehearsed that story. Now the Vietnamese had bought it. I was in an E model, but they say it's a D. I didn't know what day it was because you flew until you got tired and then you took time off. All I knew was the comics were in color, so it's Sunday it happened. And a new month had happened. So I said it was July 1st. It was actually July 3rd, but they still put the 1st in there. And if you look at Steve's name, that's not the correct spelling of his name, but it's close to a nickname. That's all I'm going to say. So again, it gives us two bits of information. One, at that point, they did not have him physically. They didn't have his ID card. They went with what I gave him. And then when we got into the bio, an interesting thing about the bio, the Vietnamese didn't really care about the Geneva Convention. They would ask you who your family members were. If you filled it in, you got mail. If you didn't, they decided you shouldn't get any mail. So I was just babbling away, having a good time talking to them. And I said, you know, I read the news. I know the war is unpopular back home. So that came out as an unjust war. I don't know where they got the part about taking care of my family, but the Angela Davis thing, they were enamored with Angela Davis and communism. So at that point, I chimed in that I had a girlfriend who looked exactly like Angela Davis. So I became a supporter of her. to extend that story, and I'll get a little ahead of myself, on the way up the trail, I picked up 14 girlfriends by name. Before I was released, I was married. I had a child. I had a picture of my child. The upshot is, when they released me, they actually gave me my wedding ring. Interesting. Turns out it was the aircraft commander's wedding ring. But the Vietnamese do not like to lose face. And one thing that has come out lately is they were anal about keeping records. When there was a crash, they collected everything. Shoelaces, teeth, boots, scraps of metal, cataloged it all and put it in a warehouse in Hanoi. So when it was time for me to be released, the last story that I told them was I was married and had a kid. There's this gold wedding ring in the packet. They assumed it was mine. They gave it to me. Turns out it was his wedding ring. So now we know they got him. And tradition was, when you got in the jungle, if the villagers caught you first, they beat the living snot out of you. And they took all the gold you had. So if you had gold teeth, you want to keep your mouth shut, because they would yank them. And the rings. And then the militia would come in and beat the snot out of them and collect it all up. And that's how it ended up in the warehouse. That was that story. Now, the story about Chuck Jackson. I had never seen Chuck Jackson before in my life. We went to the same school. I had never even seen the guy. And they came up with this story, which is a compilation of the initial interview in the jungle, showing up in prison. They just pulled this out and it made good press. So I'm reunited with my old buddy that I've never seen before. So typical journalistic license. Now, propaganda picture of me. I did get mail from home, so I got to read my mail. I'm going to talk about some battles I had with the Vietnamese. And you try to win some battles even if you are losing the war. When I got into prison, they threw me in a solitary cell, which was almost as big as this hangar. So I started making friends with the mosquitoes and the rats and everything to keep my brain going. I only had one request. Didn't matter if you're going to beat me to death, you don't have to feed me or anything, but I have to have a mosquito net. Mosquitoes love me. And their response was, you'll get it when your mind is right. Everybody else got one automatically, but because I brought it up, I didn't get one the first night. But that was only fair play, because once I hit the ground and realized they weren't going to shoot me, they weren't going to torture me, and they even said, you're a misguided patriot, but we got to keep you. We have nothing against you, but your country is really screwed up. So now I'm thinking, I've been to survival school at the Academy, Fairchild, Clark. This is graduate school. What can I get away with? And my whole mission after that was to mess with them and see how I could do that, which I'd already started in the interrogation. So the original story was the men who had been there for 8 years, a lot of them had gotten beaten because they wouldn't bow. And I had said, I don't have a problem with bowing. I'm not going to get beat over that. I'll bow all day long. The person who came in first when I got into Hilton said, you're in the Orient now. We revolve around politeness. So when someone enters your cell, you stand up. I can buy that. Okay. So he leaves. A couple hours later, I hear the bolt open. Guy walks in. Check out his rank. He's a two-striper. I stand up, and he gets this far from my nose and says, you stand at attention when I come in the room, which was a wrong thing to say. Giant red flag. So I politely explained to him, kind of like the guy I did in Bridge on the River Kwai, you know, Geneva Convention, rank is rank, we respect rank. I outrank you, I don't have to stand at attention for you. So now we get in a yelling contest. And finally, I just tell him what he can do with his horse that he rode in on. The original guy comes in, separates us, takes him out, tries to explain the facts of life to me. But I would have gotten beaten over that. And we all have our buttons that we push. Turns out I would see this guy again. So, you know, payback's tough. So they take him away. Now they come in and ask me, and this is where Rule 3 comes in. He says, would you like to write a letter home? Of course. But you can't mess with it. I write it and you leave it alone. And I'm bracing for the hit. He doesn't hit me. Okay. So he gives me a little book. I write the letter home. He takes it. comes back a couple of hours later, and it's like your first composition. There's red marks and stuff crossed out and all this. And I look at it and say, what's this? And he says, well, we have a few suggestions. I said, no. We made an agreement. So now he starts negotiating. We went through 5 rewrites before we got something that we could both agree on. And the big thing, you know, first thing he said was, you call us North Vietnam. Well, we're the Democratic Republic of Vietnam. So? I'm writing to my mama. She calls you North Vietnam. And we argued back and forth, and he finally won, so I lost that battle. But in red, you'll see certain things in there, like, I know there's a have missing in there. I'm good at English. That was purpose, okay? Suppose is spelled wrong. Again, those are on purpose. My nickname is BB. That's a message secret to my mom. Okay, all of those are secret messages to my mom. So you establish little things like that to know that she knows that I'm okay. But yeah, it was an interesting thing to get that letter out. These are the battles. The initial interrogation, I got away with the lie. So anything in black, I think I won. The red, I lost. The green, I considered a tie. So the initial interrogation was very interesting. He asked, okay, we know you're from Udorm. We did the name, rank, serial number, date of birth, but I want to know the outfits there. So, well, we got the 13th, we got the 14th, we got the triple nickel. They've been there forever. And we have the 58th, the 523rd, and the 308th TDY. So I took all those numbers, threw them in the air, made up some numbers, and gave them to him. And he opened the drawer and pulled out his little note and said, you're a little confused. And he told me what they actually were. So then he said, okay, who's your wing commander? I said, well, it's Charlie Gabriel. Charlie had left about a month earlier. So he pulled out his little note again and said, you're doing better. Okay. So now I know how good their intel is, how close. And we played that game all day long, just messing with them. I got to Hanoi and they said, how would you like to talk to some MiG pilots, as if I have a choice? Okay, sure. So they took me down to a little room, put some cookies and beer out. These 3 guys come in with the G suits on and the helmets. And they said, okay, they put a map out and say, would you draw your route for us? I said, well, okay. They gave me a red pen, which they shouldn't have done. So I left Udorn, came over through Bankarai Pass, through the target area, back out over the water to the tanker, back in, drew a fish, back through the other pass, McGee, came back in, wrote my name, back out to the tanker, came in, drew a heart, back out down to Da Nang, back up. I just doodled all over the map. Now, the interesting thing in the Orient is saving face. Now, if I had refused to do anything, they would have had to beat me. But it didn't matter number one, they weren't really looking for that anyway, but the fact that I did something satisfied them. Okay, tuck that away. Now they get to what they really wanted to know. They wanted to know, what do you know about MiG sweeps? So now I go back into my, I don't know anything mode, I just got here. I'm just taking pictures. Background on this, we all got a medical exam when we got there. Okay, everybody had a rash on your armpits and in your crotch. So we all had VD. So the standard thing is, you guys come over and you bomb churches, schools, women, children, and you go home and chase women at night. I thought, I don't know about the first part, but I like that second part. So now they get in there and they said, okay, what do you know about MiG sweeps? I don't know anything. What are you talking about? They said, oh, that's where you guys come up and pretend to be bombers. You're really fighters and get us up and shoot us. I said, I don't know anything about that. So he said, well, you must know about that. You hear the guys talking about it in the bar. And now I'm biting my tongue because I'm trying not to laugh because they've taken the bait now, and I'm about to set it. And I said, now, didn't I just get through telling you I'm downtown chasing women at night? Why would I want to be in the bar listening to the boys? Folded up their map and left. It was the only time they basically admitted they had been had, but they walked into that one. So got away from that one. The guy that I had the argument with, we call the rules man, because he showed up in camp later, and he was the one in charge of the packages. And he was a real prick. If you got a raisin, it got cut in half. If you got a cookie, and you got crumbs. Vitamins got cut in half. The only time I saw him happy was my mom sent me a box of Cracker Jacks and he got the toy surprise. He finally figured he had found what he was looking for. But then they took us on a field trip to their museum downtown. They apologized because they said, we got a complete F4 and a complete F-105, but we took them to the mountains for safety. And I believe it, because they had every piece of equipment that I had ever seen intact. And they also had, you know, miscellaneous helmets and stuff. They had microfilm. They had everything that the government tried to send in. So I understand what this guy was after. But he was an interesting character. The letter home I talked about, I got that out. So I think I won that one. They caught me off guard when they said, you have to shave your mustache because only monkeys have hair on their face. And I just complied. I didn't have sense enough to argue with that one. But haircut. They came in about a month after we got there, and I was in with a bunch of other guys. Guy comes in with the barber's clippers and says, you have to have a haircut. So I maneuvered to the back of the line. When it was my turn, I packed mine down and said, look, I don't need a haircut. And instead of saying, sit down and shut up, he said, no, I know how to cut your hair. I said, no, you don't. And we had another guy in the camp, another black guy, Norris Charles. And he said, well, I cut Norris's hair. And I said, I know, I've seen his head. You're not touching mine. Got away with it. Next time he came, I grabbed the clippers from him and I cut everybody else's hair. So I never got a haircut the whole time I was there. I'm out of regulation there, but I said, who's going to tell me to cut my hair? My old squadron commander did. He said, boy, get a haircut. I had a nice Afro pick with me. They thought that was a weapon, kind of like TSA, so they took that away. Wouldn't give it back, but they let me cut one out of bamboo, which they thought was a big joke. One of the guys, we had two guards, Philau, who was a prima donna. His dad was in the Foreign Service, and he didn't get his hands dirty. He spoke good English. Ugg was one step above Cro-Magnon, spoke no English, but he liked to play, so he was fun. He was a tank driver. And we'd always roll up his sleeve and see if he had any chain marks on him, because we always told him they chained their guys to the tanks and guns. But Ugg brought the razor blades in. We'd shave once a week. Normally they'd bring us one blade, but one day Ugg bought two blades. So what are you going to do? I'm going to steal the extra one, of course. I don't know what I'm going to do with it, but I'm going to steal it. Took it back to the room, and I only told one person in the room where I had it. After the siesta, normal routine is we would take a siesta after lunch while they took their siesta and we're locked in. Well, Ugg comes in at the end of the siesta, opens a little peephole, holds up the empty razor and gestures. And he looks square at me because I'm the troublemaker in the room, obviously. And I pick up everything in the room I can find to ask him if this is it, this is it. No. The last thing I picked up was a honey bucket, which was an insult to him, so he left. Went and practiced, came back about 20 minutes later and said, razor blade. I said, oh, it's out there in the wash area. Well, opened the door, I went out. I'm looking around like it should be there. Ugg's looking around. Well, the guy had told where it was, brought it out, and said, look, just drop it. Neither one of us should find it. Ugg should find it, because it would look unnatural if we find it. Ugg walks over it, trips over it, never finds it. We go back to the cell. After the siesta, the other guard comes in, looks at me and says, you, officer, want to talk to you. Put on the long clothes. We had the short outfit, and then we had the long clothes when you had to go talk to somebody. So I put on my long clothes. And I tell the guys in the room, here's how it's going to work. They're going to come back after I'm gone and say that I fessed up. You better come clean. Don't even think about it. Well, I headed over to see the guy, and we called him Plato because his thing was, I know the American people better than you do. And that was his belief. And I'm waiting for him to ask me about the razor blade. He doesn't ask me a thing about the razor blade. Meanwhile, they go in and tear up the cell, find everything else we've stole, but not the razor blade. So I'm sitting down, we got the cookies, and he starts talking about the U.S. And he says, what do you think about Martin Luther King? I said, well, nonviolent man, I think he's pretty, oh no, he's a violent man. Really? I said, yeah. So he looks in Coretta's book, goes to the index, finds Selma, Alabama, flips back. Before Dr. King came to Selma, Alabama, whenever the KKK came to town, the black folk went and hid under the bed. Dr. King came and talked to them. They stood on the porch, thumbed their noses at the KKK. That meant they were ready to fight, which meant he was a violent man. You got me. I didn't know that. Okay. What about Julian Bond? Julian Bond, well, you know, young guy, he's an old man. So he goes back to the index, flips open, distinguished graduates of Morehouse College, Benjamin Banneker, George Washington Carver, all these old guys, and Julian Bond. He said, they're all old. All right, it's okay. I'm 0 for 2. So then he says, gets to what he really wants. He pulls out this letter and says, would you like to sign this letter again? Don't ask the question and give me an answer that I can say no to. No, I don't want to sign it. He says, why not? All your brothers down south signed it. I looked at it again and said, what brothers? He said, all these guys are black guys. I said, how do you know that? He said, well, I can tell by the names. Thomas Jefferson so-and-so, George Washington so-and-so, Lincoln so-and-so, Willie so-and-so. Okay, I'm 0 for 3 today. Just remind me when I go home to tell Willie Nelson he's one of us. And of course, that went over his head. And that was the end of the interview. But again, they had a habit, bad habit, of asking me if I wanted to do something or give me an option to say no. Well, okay, I'll say no. So we got through that. The early release, they released 3 people early in September. I found out I was in the running. There were only 2 black guys in the camp, and Norris was the other guy. But the guard came in and said, you were on the list, not very long, because you're such a butthole. There is no way we're going to let you go. So, but like I said, I was there just to mess with them and have fun. The guys in the cell finally told me to back off and leave them alone, because I had a chip on my shoulders. They're not going to hurt me. Well, let's try something. They came in at Thanksgiving and let us, normal letter was 7 lines. You could write 7 lines. So they gave us a whole 8.5 by 11 sheet and said, you can write 14 lines for Thanksgiving. Well, I wrote 35 lines. And a guy comes in and says, what the? So we had a long discussion about the weight of the ink and postage and all that, but we got it out. So I just don't like following directions. Now, the dossier thing is interesting. The rules man ran our packages. Well, I had the other guys distract him one day, and I knew they kept our stuff in a file cabinet. And I looked in there and found my folder. They had information in there that I had never given them. I thought, there's a Soviet influence here. And you think back, all the news releases, the hometown news releases you send out, somebody's going through the trash, going through the newspaper, sending all that stuff straight to Moscow. They had information on us. So I quit filling out hometown news releases. But that was pretty interesting, so I lost that one. And then I told you about the wedding ring deal with the girlfriends. They were fascinated that you could have more than one girlfriend, or that you could have more than one newspaper in a city, or that 20 families didn't live in a house the size that we have. But that was it. Those were the battles. This is the release. The last chance they had to mess with me. We were split up into 4 groups for the release. Those who were wounded and those who were there the longest got to go first. So obviously I'm in the 4th group. 3rd group left. So we're all there. We're the only ones left. Walter Cronkite's been there, so I know we're going home. And they come in the day before release and said, your side's violating the agreement. We're going to have to keep some of you. The guy in front of me got to go. Me and 59 others got to stay. And we only stayed one day, but just to mess with us. So I was first in line when we got to Guillaume to get on the airplane, and nobody breathed a sigh of relief until we got feet wet and 12 miles out, because we didn't trust those guys. This is my Forrest Gump story. We got to go to the White House, meet President Nixon. And at that point, President Nixon was on his way out anyway. The standard thing, just like Forrest Gump, you go down the standard receiving line, you tell somebody your name, they tell it to somebody else who tells it to the president, and he says, hi, welcome home. And I thought, that's too easy. One more chance to meth with somebody. So I gave my camera to a guy in front of me and said, just be ready. So did the standard thing, shook my hand, and he released, but I didn't. I just tightened my grip on him, see what he's going to say now. So that's the moment. And he said, we're having a party in Georgetown tonight. I hope you can make it. And I said, I'll see you there. But it was just kind of fun to do that. Some of you already know Mike Christian's story, but Mike was there a long time, managed to make a flag out of lint and cotton stuff. And, you know, all the guys there saluted the flag and everything, said the Pledge of Allegiance. And the point is, the flag becomes extremely important when you get in these situations. A lot of people take it for granted, but Vietnamese discovered the flag one day and they just beat Mike severely. Didn't matter, he dragged him back to the cell, he started making his new flag. One of the things that doesn't make a lot of news, but there are probably almost 10 times as many people out there claiming to be veterans as there are really veterans. There are a lot more prisoners that are out there collecting VA benefits. So again, somebody must think what we did was worth doing because they're pretending to be like the people that have done this. And this is just a comment on the way the war went. We could have won this war. We played it with both hands tied behind our back. It was worth going over there, but not worth dying for the way we played. The rules were just silly. Okay, so that's all I'm going to say about that. I'm going to open it up to questions. Questions. And the question was the Othello story. We're sitting in the cell one day. Actually, we're sitting out on the front porch watching the war go by. And this was at the zoo, which was the camp on the outskirts, their show camp. The guard comes by, looks at me, laughs, and walks off. Another guard comes by, does the same thing. And this happens about four or five different guards come by, look at me, and laugh. Okay, that's cute. So then they said, all right, guys, put on long clothes. We're going to take you over to show you a film. And so the person in charge gets on the stage and says, okay, we've got a real treat for you today. We're going to show you the Moscow Circus, the Bolshoi Ballet, and then we're going to show you O-10-O by Chasper. And we're all wondering, what? And then they roll the film. It's Othello. And of course, I'm the Moor. So that was what they got their joke about. Then at the end, they have the mandatory propaganda film. So they got a bunch of kids, a bunch of Cubans to play Americans. And these guys are Marines, and they're on this island of the palm tree or coconut tree. Kids all around them who are supposed to be little Vietnamese kids. And one of the Marines wants a coconut, so he looks at the kid. The kid goes up and gets a coconut. Well, while the kid's up there and all the Marines are watching, the kids steal all their hand grenades and everything, blow them all up, and save the day. Okay. We're headed back to our cell, and we walk by the papaya tree, and I look at Ugg and says, Ugg got all bent out of shape because he thought I called him a monkey. And he and I played this game the whole time there. Interesting thing to compare the headlines. They gave us the Stars and Stripes, but they cut out all the good news. If there was a tornado, a flood, a killing or anything, we got that. But if you looked at the headlines and compared it to their paper, they had the same numbers. You know, we shot down 27 airplanes. We had one blown tire on landing. We killed 4,000 of them, wounded 32,000, and we had two people with broken arms. We killed more trucks than the Soviet bloc could ever build. They shot down more airplanes than the whole Western alliance ever built. Both sides spin a little bit of tail with that. One thing I neglected to mention is we took off from Da Nang at 2 p.m. according to the records. We went down at 6 p.m. I don't remember that 4 hours. I don't remember a lot around the ejection. There's an awful lot of my memory that's totally gone. Now, part of that is the shock associated with this ejection seat coming out. And the old brain just says, there's too much information coming in, take a nap, I'll wake you up later. But it's bothered me for a while that I don't remember a lot about that. I don't know what happened. We ended up being 60 miles north of where I thought we were, which totally screwed up my escape plans because nothing looked right. I was going to escape the first night because they put me in the classic Three Little Pigs straw hut. Paper-thin walls, the wooden bars in the cell you could lift out. I'm out of here tonight. Now, we all had some stupid ideas. Most of the guys I flew with said there were three things we're going to do because we're not going to ever be captured. Well, number one, we're never going to be shot down. If we are shot down, we're never going to get captured because I don't want to go through what John and those guys went through. So, you can ride the airplane in, solve all your problems, or you can jump out, and if things get too bad, save one bullet and blow your brains out. I can't do A or B. C, if you really don't want to get caught, start a land battle with that silly 38, and they'll take care of you. So that was the only option that was even remotely acceptable to me. Luckily, I was in shock and never got to do that. It would have been dumb. But you just have some silly ideas in your life. Now, I mentioned Roger Locker. He spent, I think it was 23 days on the ground, E&Eing. Roger and I used to sit in the vaults, look at the MiG-1s, because we were going to steal a MiG if we ever got shot down. He almost got to that point. He said that he had been there so long, he was going to go steal a MiG and go home, knowing he was going to get caught. But the other thing was get in the Red River, figure out 5-knot current, 12 hours, 60 miles will take you out, and you can swim out to the 7th Fleet. Yeah. I was going to get in the canal that I knew went down to the Quan Ki, which I knew went out to the Gulf of Tonkin, and I was going to swim out to the 7th Fleet. And I almost got kicked out of the academy because I can't even make it across a pool. But I was going to do that silly thing. The other silly thing, I had planned to escape the first night. Now that I got my wits somewhat about me, they've got my boots, they've got my radio up front where they are, but they put me in the back room in this straw hut. So I'm just going to take the bars out of the window, get up about 2 o'clock, and I'm gone. I don't need the radio. I don't need the boots. I don't know where I'm going, but I'm going. Well, they put me in there at about 9 o'clock, bedtime. And as John can tell you, the bed is just this board. And the mattress is this little beach blanket made out of wheat. Okay. I don't care because I'm not going to be here that long. So I lay down. About 10 minutes later, they come in with the leg irons, and not just, you know, your chain gang leg irons. They put this horseshoe over your ankles and run a 6-foot steel rod through it. So now I'm on my back with this contraption on, thinking, well, there goes plan A. Try to get some sleep, and about 20 minutes later, I'm skin and bones, and my bones are hitting this board, and I cannot sleep on my back. I can't turn over either because of this contraption. So I'm doing this contortion. And every time I turn, the leg irons are making noise. It's keeping them awake. So they come in and taking them off. And I think, I'm back to plan A. They came in and woke me up at 9 o'clock the next morning. I'd overslept. And again, because we flew until we were exhausted. And you know, with the shock of all this and just normal physical exhaustion, I overslept. But being a great rationalizer, I figured they were expecting me to try something tonight. I've just lulled them into relaxing now because I didn't. I'll leave tomorrow night. So I was all set to do that. They came in, said, let's go. Threw me in a truck and we took off. But I had another plan because I knew there was a river we had to cross. I knew we had blown up all the bridges. They would have to take a ferry boat across. By now in this little truck, I know where my radio is, I know where my boots are. I'm gonna grab both of them, do a half gainer into the water, and swim out to the 7th Fleet. And I know from watching Sea Hunt, because Lloyd Bridges told me that bullets only go 6 inches under the water. Talk about stupid. Luckily, we got to the river, and it was like the 405 at rush hour. The bridge was in place, and the little guys had built the superstructure just below the low tide, and we thought it was always gone. They just built it every night. There were a lot of ways they showed us that we were not the brightest ones at prosecuting this war. What happened to my pilot? There were two stories. The original story was they were talking to him when it got dark, and the last transmission was, I'll see you in the morning. A later version that I've heard was they were talking to him, they heard gunshots, they were not talking to him. So we're pretty sure that he ended up getting himself killed. Now, another thing. The Vietnamese beat the crap out of John and the early guys. Vietnamese have a strange idea of what life is. If I beat you for 10 years, but I'm good to you in the last 5 minutes, you should remember that I'm good to you. So, and this goes with the saving face, why they never came back to me and said, well, you told me this yesterday and the day before you told me that. The latest story was it. So it's kind of interesting the way they look at things like that. In fact, they said, we don't understand you guys. What you're essentially saying to us is you have to beat us and then we'll tell you anything you want to know. And, you know, they don't have a real value on life like that. What they had told the villagers, when an airplane goes down, you got to stop beating these guys. You have to turn the pilot over alive. Unfortunately, in that simple society, an airplane has a pilot. Two people in an airplane is excess. So the first person caught fulfills all their obligations. They're going to get one commendation, one bag of rice. Turn over two people or 10 people, you get the same thing. So there's no incentive to be nice to the second person caught. That may be what happened to him. Every day, it took 5 days to go up the trail, but every day they would get the villagers out, bring me out, give them a big rally, you know, you're doing a great job, we're winning this war, and they look at me and say they hate you because you've killed their brothers and their fathers and their sons. And it'd just be women and girls and kids. And I'm standing there trying to be Joe Cool, checking out the girls. The only people that were allowed to come inside the circle that they had cordoned off were the old ladies. And most of the folks that I talked to said an old lady would just come up, haul off, and sock them right upside the head. And I just basically had one old lady come up, look at me with a sickle in her hand, but she didn't touch me. But as far as we know, we don't know what happened to him. They denied, I'm sorry. Oh, no, he was MIA, later determined to be KIA. And his remains were returned probably 15 years ago now. But again, part of that story is they're only obligated to turn over one person. The Vietnamese claim they had no knowledge of him, even though they put his name out incorrectly. But they steadfastly deny any knowledge of him.
Thank you for watching Peninsula Seniors Out and About here at the Western Museum of Flight in Torrance. I'm Betty Wheaton. I'll see you next time.